I am Yako.
Today, I'm going to share how I spent last 2 days of 2020, which is making these osechi.
Osechi is Japanese traditional New Year's food. If you're not living in Japan, like me, don't worry, you can improvise it and make a great osechi. Some of the dishes are originally plant-based, but some are not. So this year, I made them all vegan. Also, osechi is made with a lot of sugar and salt for the preservation. Because first few days of the new year is very important, so that ancient Japanese people thought they are not supposed to cook during those days. Now, people don't follow that rule anymore, but the osechi is made in the same manner as the Asian days. So, as I veganize my recipe, I also reduce salt and sugar. And in this video, I'm sharing all the tips and tricks in a vlog style. Osechi is a special meal, but also has a meaning of prayer for good health, bliss in life, prosperity of descendants, and the wealth in the new year. And each dish has a meaning. So I'm gonna share how to make them and also what they mean. So it's gonna be the busiest 2 days of the year. And let's go! So I'm going to start with the one takes the longest to cook, which is this cooked black soybeans called the kuromame. Beans are called mame in Japanese, and mame also means health in old Japanese. So this dish has a meaning of hope for the health. I soak the black beans overnight with plenty of water and baking soda. Baking soda is for preserving the color. I'm going to cook this over the medium to low heat until beans become tender. While they are simmering, I'm moving on to nishime. Nishime is simmered root vegetables. All the root vegetables are cooked together in one pot. So this dish represents all the family members are happily together. It's a simple dish, but since I'm gonna cut vegetables into festive shapes, it takes a labor of love and time. So these are the ingredients. So first, I'm going to soak the koya tofu, which is freeze-dried tofu. Typically, chickens are used in nishime, but to veganize it, I use these instead. Since these are freeze-dried, they absorb the broth very well. So this is a common ingredient for a similar dish in Japanese. Next up is burdock root, or also called gobo root. I'm going to peel and slice, and I'm going to start cooking with the broth of dried shiitake mushrooms. Next, I'm going to peel and cut the lotus root. I'm cutting them into flower shapes. And all the lotus flower join the pot too, along with broth from the kombu kelp. Combining two kind of broth enhance the umami of the soup. So I use half of the lotus root flour to make nishime, and I'm using other half to make these pickled pink flowers. In a pan, I'm going to add a splash of sake and lotus root flowers. Cover with a lid and cook over the low heat. This cooking method is a cross between boiling and steaming. It cooks really fast, so it's my favorite method. Now, once they're all cooked and completely cooled down, I'm going to pickle them with this ume plum vinegar. This is a very salty vinegar. Add a splash of water if needed. This adds bright pink color to the lotus root. I'm sucking all the air out of the bag, so that small amount of vinegar distributes all over the ingredient. And I'm going to rest this in the fridge. Now I'm going to back on track of making nishime and cutting the carrots into flower shapes. I'm curving out the petals, and these represent plum flower. Plum flowers are popular auspicious design, so you'll see a lot in Japanese traditional art or design. And next veggie is taro. I'm going to peel these into hexagon shape. These are very slimy, so I'm going to massage with salt and rinse under the running water. And then join the pot. Next up is dried shiitake mushrooms. I soaked these overnight, and the soaked water became nice broth. And I'm going to cut these into the shape of tortoise shell. Turtles represent longevity, so tortoise shell is also one of the popular auspicious design. I also did the flower design too. Now let's add the carrots and shiitake mushrooms into a pot. Next, I'm going to cut the konjac into the shape of the reins, which is straps fastened to the horses and used by the warriors to drive the horse. All the Japanese people thought reins represent straps and not, and that symbolizes good relationships. Now I'm slicing konjac and make a slit on the center, and slide in one side through the hole and pull to tighten. And I got shape of reins. This is not only very auspicious, but also make it easier to pick up with chopsticks. And I'm boiling them to cook off the smell of the konjac. Next up is kombu kelp. I'm also making the knot with them to symbolize the good relationships. Now freeze-dried tofu should be softened So I'm just gonna cut into quarters. And they go to the pot. For the flavor, I'm going to add white soy sauce, which has this beautiful golden color, along with sake and mirin. I'm gonna keep on cooking while the pot is partially covered. So it has been a few hours since we started cooking black soybeans. Now they are nice and soft, so I just added coconut sugar and mirin to sweeten them. Yes, this is a sweet dish. Now I'm cutting parchment paper to make a paper lid because black beans on the surface tend to get dried and wrinkled. To prevent it, I'm covering the surface with a paper lid. Now I'm setting this aside and let the beans soak the flavor. Next, I'm going to make kohaku namasu, which is pickled daikon radish and carrots. Kohaku means red and white, and namasu means pickled dish. Red and white is traditional auspicious color combination. I'm cutting daikon radish and carrot into julienne strips. And then I'm massaging them with a pinch of salt to work them down. I'm setting this aside, and let's back to the pot. I'm adding last few ingredients, which is konjac and koya tofu. And I'm gonna let them cook furthermore. Now I'm going to make pickling brine for kohaku namasu. Into a small bowl, I'm going to add coconut sugar, rice vinegar, and the broth of the kombu kelp. Now the daikon radish and the carrot should be softened, so I'm gonna squeeze the excess water out and add the brine. I'm gonna set this in the fridge and let this develop the flavor. Next, I'm going to make these kikka kabula. Kikka means chrysanthemum, kabula means turnips, but I couldn't find turnips anywhere, so I used these small radishes instead. To make them look like a chrysanthemum flower, I'm going to slice on the surface just through halfway, and then other slices perpendicular to the prior cuts. Now these little squares represent the small petals of chrysanthemum flower. Now I'm making the brine to pickle. In the bag, I'm adding rice vinegar, coconut sugar, and salt. Mix well and let the radishes sit in the brine. Next, I'm going to make kuri kintong. Traditionally, this dish is made from chestnuts and sweet potato and colored into beautiful golden yellow. This represents gold, so this dish has a meaning of wish for the gold and money. And this year, I decided to make them into bi-colored. For this, I'm cooking purple sweet potatoes and regular Japanese sweet potatoes. I'm poking holes on both potatoes and bake in the oven for about an hour. While they are baking, I'm going to make kohagi, which is these little Japanese treats made from mochi. For this, I'm going to cut kabocha squash into small chunks. If you want to know how to cut kabocha squash easily, I have a video, so please check that out. The link is in the description box. Then I'm gonna cook these little chunks like I did with lotus root. I'm also adding a pinch of salt to enhance the sweetness. Once sweet potatoes are cooked, I'm going to puree them. Let's start with the Japanese sweet potatoes. I'm going to remove the skin and transfer it to the food processor, along with a dash of mirin. Mirin is sweet cooking sake. Blend until smooth and transfer the puree to the pan. And I'm adding turmeric for the yellow color. Traditionally, gardenia flower is used to add color, but I couldn't find, so I'm using turmeric instead. I'm going to cook this over the medium-low heat until all the sake is cooked off and become thick texture. Now into the food processor, I'm adding half of the kabocha squash. I'm reserving other half for the other dish. Blitz until smooth, and I'm adding cinnamon powder and maple syrup. This is going to be a topping for the kohagi. And also, I'm making a puree of purple sweet potato. It turned out too thick, so I'm adding soy milk to make it a smooth texture. So that's done for day one, and I'm going to have a good sleep, and let's proceed to day two. I'm starting with this datemaki. Traditionally, datemaki is rolled omelette, but to veganize it, I used the tofu instead. This dish looks like hand scroll, which is Asian-style old book, so this dish has a meaning of knowledge. So first, I'm making a baking tray out of parchment paper. I'm folding all the sides of squared parchment paper and giving a little cut on each corner. Then make walls on all sides and staple the corners. Now, for the actual ingredients, I'm using Japanese yam. I'm going to peel it and chop it and transfer to the food processor. Along with drained tofu, I'm using silky soft tofu here, kabocha squash that I batch cooked yesterday, white miso paste, arrowroot powder, and a pinch of salt. Blend until smooth and transfer it to the baking tray.
I'm going to smooth out the surface, and this goes into the oven to bake. Next, I'm going to make lotus root balls. This is not a traditional osechi dish. This is a dish I learned from my macrobiotic cuisine teacher, and this tastes so good, so I had to make them. Lotus root is a very interesting veggie. They are crunchy, but they can be very chewy, like mochi. So I'm making chewy balls with this. I'm peeling and chopping lotus roots and transfer the chunks into the food processor. And I'm gonna blitz until they are grated. Transfer this to a mixing bowl, and I'm adding arrowroot powder and panko breadcrumbs and mix well. Next, I'm going to make the filling. Into a small bowl, I'm going to add white miso paste, maple syrup, and lemon zest. I'm supposed to use the zest of yuzu citrus, but I couldn't find any yuzu citrus, so I'm using lemon instead. Now let's assemble these into a bowl. Flatten the dough and add a filling on the center. I'm gently squeezing the dough and making into a bowl. Once they are all rolled into the balls, I will steam them for 10 minutes. Let them cool completely and coat the balls with more arrowroot powder. Then I'm gonna shallow fry them with olive oil. Once they become golden brown on both sides, they're good to go. Next, I'm going to make tataki gobo, which means pounded burdock root, because this dish is made by pounding the burdock root. By pounding and smashing burdock root, the tough fiber of this veggie is loosened up and become more digestible. I'm pounding and cutting into little coins and coat the little coins with arrowroot powder. Heat the olive oil over the medium heat, and I'm adding the burdock root. Cook them until golden brown, and I'm going to add the mixture of soy sauce, rice vinegar, mirin, and undried chili. Cook them until the sauce is thickened, and I'm going to finish off with sesame seeds. Now datemaki is out of the oven, and while it's still hot, I'm going to roll this like a sushi roll using a bamboo mat. This is fragile where it's still hot, so I'm going to set this aside to settle. Once this is completely cooled down, I'm going to slice them. Isn't this looks like hand scroll, sort of? And this is ready to be enjoyed. Now let's get back to making kohagi. This year, I decided to make brown rice mochi from scratch. So I soaked up 2 parts of sweet brown rice and 1 part of brown rice. I'm cooking the rice in the pressure cooker. And once they are fully cooked, I'm pounding the rice to make a rice cake. Now I'm rolling this rice cake into a small balls. I wet my hands and rolling out the balls about the size of 1 tablespoon. And using a pureed sweet potato, I'm making a swirl on top. I'm making purple kohagi using purple sweet potato and orange kohagi using cinnamon flavored kabocha squash puree that I made yesterday. For the finishing touch, I'm going to add hemp seeds on purple kohagi and black sesame seeds on the orange ones. Now let's place this in a lacquered box. I'm placing kohagi on the corner of the box. And then fill the center section. I'm going to fill the lotus root balls along with pickled pink lotus flower and steamed snow peas for garnish. These are nicely pickled and become pink overnight. And in the middle, I'm going to place these kikakabura radishes to make them look like blooming in the center. Next up is kohaku namasu. I made this little cup by scooping out the flesh out of the lemon. Again, this cup is supposed to be made with yuzu citrus, but I just improvised with lemon. Now this tier is completed. Let's move on to the next tier. I'm placing all the appetizers in this tier. I'm placing 2 small bowls to separate the section. First, I'm placing datemaki on top right corner. Then I'm gonna place bicolored kurikinton. On the plastic wrap, I place a dollop of sweet potato that I made yesterday and squeeze to foam it into a bowl. This method of forming a bowl using traditionally a cloth, not a plastic wrap, is called the chakin shibori. Chakin is a cloth used in tea ceremony, and shibori means the squeezing motion. So chakin shibori basically means squeezing with the cloth. And I top them off with goji berries and cooked chestnuts. Usually, candied chestnuts is used for this dish, but I couldn't find candied chestnuts, so I improvised with these toppings to add more color and fun. Then I realized this tier looks too yellow overall, so I decided to add kikakabura radish in this tier too. So I'm moving things around here, and at last, I'm going to place black soybeans into a bowl. Now 2 tiers are filled, let's move on to the last tier. This tier is entirely for nishime. This year, I decided to place each ingredient on its own sections. And for the decoration, I distribute plum-shaped carrots, and garnished steamed snow peas. Now 3 tiers are filled and ready to be enjoyed. I know 2020 has been a difficult year for all of us, but I'm sending a prayer for all of you guys with this osuji meal. Because delicious meals are not only the food for our body, but for our soul too. So Happy New Year, everyone, and let the great year begin. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe. Thank you so much for watching, and see you in the next one. Bye!